So Donna Penton and Robbie Harris, it's now 103 days. Still no word yet as to what happened to 1 4-month-old LaMelo. We believe that sometime this week we will get word that maybe the investigation, as per the Biloxi PD, has been handed over to the DA. Right now, you're getting the silence, huh, bro?
I am. I was able to speak with someone in the DA's office yesterday and told that I could at least expect to have some confirmation on that sometime this week, but no definite timetable.
So as we anxiously wait, how it was that a 4-month-old was killed in the middle of I-10 on a busy on a busy highway at somewhere in broad daylight. Well, as we wait, ladies and gentlemen, trust me on this, we will continue our countdown. And for those who don't know this, this is not unusual for this broadcast. It is called Radioactive Radio. Yeah, I mean, we don't just talk the talk, we walk the walk, and we're the only broadcast facility that does it, seemingly here in the state, and we don't mind. It's what being local is all about, is local participation. Keep that in mind, which is why we are the number one Nielsen-rated broadcast on the coast, and thanks to you for that happening. 228-896-9455 is the number to call. I've got a troubling email here that I had to give some thought about sharing, and I've obviously decided that I'm going to share it with you, with all that is happening now with COVID-19. Family come first, folks, and this is a family discussion. It's from, doesn't matter who it's from. It is involving a very serious family situation. I had asked some time ago about whether or not you would allow your child to be vaccinated, and there was a question as to whether or not a child can be vaccinated without his or her parent. And the answer to that is no. Unless that child is 18 or older, they cannot go in and get a vaccination without a parent or guardian, _guardian. As a result of that, I had the aunt of a young lady who is 17 and soon to turn 18, who sought to help her niece. She says here, Mr. Daniels, I listened very closely to your show when you were talking about whether or not a child can get a vaccine without permission of the parents, and I understand that a child cannot get a vaccine without permission of the parent and guardian, _. As a result of that, I know that my niece has pre-existing conditions. She's got several here, including weight and some other things, respiratory disease. And she said, my niece begged me to get the vaccine, primarily because she wanted to become a flag girl, and that she was very afraid that she would get the disease and would die. Her mother, my sister, did not want her to have a vaccine. We had very long conversations about it, and my sister did not understand that the vaccine had been tested. I said to her, but you've had the vaccine. To which she responded, that's me, and she's my daughter, and this thing has not been tested for what the long-term effects will be. I agreed, and I thought that was that, until my niece called me later on that night and begged me to get a vaccine, to which I took her down to a drugstore and signed off as her mother, and she got the vaccine. So here you have the aunt, Ro, signing off for the niece whose mother told her not to have the vaccine. She goes on to say, My sister still doesn't know. I feel somewhat guilty, but I am relieved with the thought that my niece will not get deathly ill. I am hopeful that she will forgive me. Like they say, it's better sometimes to ask for forgiveness than to get permission. Heard that before. Besides, my niece will turn 18 in just a few months, and what's the difference? So, two things. You think this was a betrayal, sister to sister?
Yeah. I mean, it's a betrayal of trust, if nothing else. The mother, the sister, made it clear her wishes. At the same time, it's the aunt stepping up for the niece, you know, who sounds like had serious concerns, as the aunt did as well. So, you know, it is a betrayal of sister, but it's also stepping up and, you know, being there for the niece.
Hmm. Along the lines on this one, you know, this is, folks, let me just tell you, this is, although we love our children and so forth, we must realize it's their life and their death. Now, granted, we're responsible for them whenever they get sick and otherwise, but they will be the ones suffering there, not us. I wonder about the input, is what I wonder about. In other words, I just wonder whether or not if a child, even if they're 15, 13, is saying that they would like to have the vaccine because they are afraid, regardless of the consequence. Should a parent at least consider that? You know, I'm thinking now as a parent, in other words, that, because look, folks, let me just tell you, there's got to be some anxiety. Although we want to look out for them, our children, the fact that they know other children who have COVID, got me? And they could very well have seen other children who were deathly ill with COVID. You know, that in itself, I think, could result in some weakness of the immune system. You know what I'm saying? You know, this whole thing is, being positive is very helpful when it comes to just getting ill, period.
Absolutely.
Keeping a positive attitude, and as a father, I just wonder. Now, I could tell you right off the bat, I'd have some reluctance with giving my daughter any kind of medication. They've got the vaccines for, what is this,
HPV?
Yeah, HPV, very good. You know, and of course, I've heard from physicians that it's no big deal. It is effective, blah blah blah. But I still have not heard nearly long term enough to make me feel comfortable with that. But if my daughter said, "Yeah, I'd like to have that," and was very very dead set on that, I think I'd have to give it some considerations. I really would, folks. Need to check things over there, bro. You would. However, in this case, with the aunt signing on as guardian, you really broke the law. You know that, don't you? I'm not going to give any names. I don't know if this is your real name or not. You didn't give me. You said you had the same last name. You didn't give me that. So fine. That's why I'm sharing it. I think if it were me, I think I would go and tell my sister. And let the chips fall where they may. It's your sister. You know how she's going to react or not. The sister really did usurp her parental authority.
I mean, she committed medical fraud.
Yeah.
If we're being honest.
Yeah. So if you were the other sister, I know he said, let's just say the other brother, just for the sake of this discussion. So how would you respond to that? How do you think another parent should respond if, in fact, a relative of yours took it upon themselves to say, look, now this girl, She is vulnerable, and you need to go ahead and do this. By the way, I failed to mention in the early on, the sister had had COVID and had a very rough go of it, and she didn't want her niece experiencing that. The mother has a vaccination. The sister has a vaccination.
Right. I would hope that I could be understanding after the fact. I'm speaking, you know, purely anecdotally. I have no frame of reference on any of this. But I would hope that I would see past the betrayal and to the quest to protect my child as the cause of this, you know, and really look, you know, beyond just the conflict between me and my sibling and look at the safety of the child. I hope, you know, I can't even fathom how that would feel, but I would like to think that if I'm vaccinated, my brother is vaccinated, he takes my child to get vaccinated. The overarching theme here is we're doing everything we can to stay as safe as we can, as least sick as we can.
Well, I don't know. I would really have a hard time if my brother did that. I really, really would. And I love my brother. I would have a very hard time if he did that. I mean, you're only looking at 2 months before this girl turned 18. You know, there's got to be some solidarity among adults and parents. You know,
Really and truly, that's really the other thing, because at this point now, when this child, who's not yet 21, wants to drink or go get a tattoo or whatever,
yeah,
they're going to go to that aunt or that uncle.
Oh, the cool one, right?
The cool one.
Yeah, the cool
uncle. Which I am. I'm the cool uncle. So whenever my nephews want something, my niece wants something, they come to me.
Yeah, they know that you'll go behind their parents' back and do something for them, huh?
Absolutely.
Yeah, let them smoke a cigarette and drink some beer.
Well, if they're 21, or 18 at least.
I don't know. We'll open the lines up. Go to our Facebook page and weigh in whether or not, first and foremost, whether or not you think that 17-year-olds should be vaccinated. And the next thing is whether or not you think that a relative, or you wouldn't hold against another relative for doing what they thought was proper for your child. I mean, come on, folks. There was a time when, guess what? You didn't mind that relative whooping their behind if they saw them do something wrong. Remember those days? Yeah, I get my butt whipped, and then I go down there, nigga. Well, okay, so what happened? What happened? If you can trust that same aunt to whoop some butt when the child does something wrong, then... All right, 228-896-9455. Hang on, Larry, I'm going to get you. Good to see you, too, by the way. We're going to get to you. But he's no longer persona non grata. Jerome, Donald John's pet Negro.
Romy Rome is in the building.
Whoa. Who would ever think? And he's actually being critical.
Romy Rome is pulling no punches.
Why are you talking like that?
Like what?
Like Jerome, but you got that list.
Because I've been listening to this interview with CBS this morning, all morning, dissecting it, and it seems as though Jerome Adams has come out with the gloves off.
You mean he's come out of the closet? Is that what you're saying?
No, he is a heterosexual male, but he's come out with the gloves off, not in the closet, come out with the gloves off and the beard on.
How do you know he's, he's heterosexual, he has a beard now?
Well, no, he's married to a woman, and they have a child together, so at least, he was at least heterosexual for at least 5.6 seconds.
Bro, you're going to get us in trouble.
That's fine. I take all scrutiny as it comes.
Can I hear from this guy? So who is he? Who is he? He's now...
Jerome Adams was talking to CBS this morning about the mask mandate, or the mandate against the mask mandate, specifically in Florida. This was his response.
Florida's governor says the state could withhold the salaries of school officials who defies order to ban mask mandates. As a physician, as a father, what's your reaction to that?
Well, as a physician, as a public health expert, it is deeply troubling that it seems we're letting politics get in the way of protecting our youth. As a father, I quite frankly think it's unconscionable. I really do. I think you can't tie the hands of school and public health officials based on what you perceive to be the reality when your public health officials are telling you they need these tools.
And you've said recently that this pandemic is spiraling out of control again. What do you think the next few weeks, the next few months are going to look like?
Well, we're going to see more spread, unfortunately. And today I'm touring Oklahoma University Health Center. We're hearing that our nurses, our doctors, they are quite simply overwhelmed. We're going to see
So he's actually being critical of Governor DeSantis, the boy, Donald John's boy.
It's unconscionable. As a father and a doctor, in his opinion...
It's amazing how you sound like this guy, but...
In his opinion...
He doesn't have that much lisp, bro.
Unconscionable.
I think this...
Frankly, I'm very happy to see him out front and center once again and really telling the truth to the American people about just how unsafe these elected officials are leaving their children.
Well, I can tell you one thing. This is the first time that sounds like he's rebuffing the double impeached Donald John. He's suggesting it's political, but no one made it more political than Donald John, his boss, former boss.
These are facts.
You didn't say anything about it then, Tyrone.
Jerome.
Oh, okay, fine.
Jerome. So don't play that Erykah Badu song. Come back. It's not the same thing.
That's your brother, I guess. So, I mean, you didn't say anything about it then?
And then I didn't, because I was the Surgeon General of the United States of America, and I did everything I could to support my president. However, I have never, ever pulled any punches when it comes to the severity and the seriousness of COVID-19.
Well, you did.
Especially when it comes to, I learned it from him, by the way.
I know, you said, just like Donald.
Wearing masks and being around other people and social distancing.
Well, I got news for you. They kept you in a closet there, and I said, least, and they just rolled you out, darted you out whenever they just needed to add some color to the bouquet. And you did your job. And look, I'm not condemning you.
I don't dispute a word you're saying right now.
I know you don't, because that was your job, and that's what you were supposed to do. But at the very least now, you grew some, gonads.
Hair on my face.
Hair on your face, okay, yeah, go ahead. I know you.
I have those because I'm a father.
Well, I know, but you just can't tell about your voice.
That's fine.
You know, folks, for DeSantis to even threaten, what is it with masks, you guys? I'm trying to figure this out. When did schools and churches and any other agencies, when did they lose their authority to regulate for the sake of health concerns people that came to their doors? You do understand what I'm talking about, right? In other words, for the sake of health, you can require that everybody wash their hands. You can require that someone wears a mask. For the sake of health, you can require that that people who have had pacemakers not come in because of the use of magnets and so forth. In other words, it's for the public good. You do understand this? I mean, that is the reason why you have to be clean and wear clothes, and that's also the reason why if your child has lice, he got to go home. You know. You can require that hair is washed. What is it with these juvenile thinking conservative kooks?
Well, you can't wear a mask. And if you wear a mask, we're going to hold back your pay. You can't mandate them.
For the public good, for the sake of health, hell yeah you can. And by the way, Governor DeSantis lost. So did Abbott in Texas. They lost in a court fight. On the one hand, they don't want government to be heavy-handed and controlled, but guess what? Government is now being heavy-handed and controlled. They're going to take your money if you say you got to wear a mask in my classroom. Do you know at one time, ladies and gentlemen, I was actually beat down because I chewed gum in class. Was it okay for y'all to chew gum in class?
Oh, no.
Well, you couldn't chew that.
No, we couldn't chew gum in class.
What happened?
They just asked us. Spit it out, or we go to the principal's office.
Really?
Yeah. Worst comes to worst, we get paddled, but that was early high school, late
middle. No, you could not wear, you could not wear chew gum, and you couldn't have the shirt tail out like this. You could not have your shirt tail out, and so therefore the chubby kids that became conservative, they don't really used to complain about it. You can't get so stuffed up anymore. This was after immigration, by the way. You know, and it was, and needless to say, Trump's, they petitioned the schools. Well, the Bellevue kids had a lot of control. Petitioned the schools to wear the straight tails out and even be able to smoke. You can actually smoke. No, really. I mean, if you're in 11th grade and you were, you know, the son or daughter of one of those Caucasian kids whose parents were cool and hip and had that kind of pull, then you can go in between the auditorium and the cafeteria and smoke. Real. Incredible. True. I'm not making it up. Now, someone, their parents would have to buy them a cigarette. But the parents said it was okay to smoke. Okay to smoke. It's all good at the time. Who was the principal? Was powerless, because after all, the school board said that these were the rich kids out of Bellevue, and so therefore, I can't make this up. I'm telling you, this is how this works. So Jerome is, I mean, he's been quite, I see you got a whole lot on Jerome, but I'm not going to get into it. He's got, he actually weighed in on the racial makeup of lower quality hospitals. I had someone talk yesterday about Johnson & Johnson being offered at some hospitals or pharmacies, I guess, where mostly African Americans were there, and I can't dispute that. I don't know what was happening there in Texas. I don't see that here. I do know that it takes, you know, in some cases, facilities are not capable of maintaining Pfizer and Moderna because of what is necessary to maintain them stored. I mean, they've got to be at sub-zero temperatures at a certain amount of time. Johnson & Johnson, on the hand, can be refrigerated. Damn it, it's there. But I want to play Tyrone one more time.
I know it's Jerome. I just wanted to hear you try to do him again.
Which clip would you prefer from the interview with CBS?
See how he goes into it? I don't know who he is.
It's like riding a bicycle. Or in Jerome's case, a unicycle.
Where did you get the prize? Where did you get the dark skinned bald head piece?
Through years of theater work, he has acquired a lot of props. So he employs those props.
I've seen the bald ones, but it, I've seen the costume, they have the bald heads like Fester, but I've never seen a brown skinned bald head like that. Did you dye it?
Well, if you look hard enough, you can find them. But the thing is, matching your skin tone, which Rove has a big problem with.
Well, look, it's not matching your ears, it's not covering your whole head.
He didn't do the whole makeup job, he just wanted to have the skull cap on for extra method.
The skull cap, that's exactly what it looks like, because it's not, you got the ears folded up, Rove. You're just showing the little bulb on the top. What is that? And of course, Jerome has this kind of a beady little egghead, but I don't know where you get this stuff from. And granted, I guess you had to put that on so you could talk that way.
Rest in peace,
Josette. Oh, Josette's on combat. Yeah, you're right. Order play number 6 here. This is where this person was asking about the double standards, I guess the inequity, I guess, between African-American healthcare and Caucasian healthcare.
Here's what you need to understand. A lot of times, these big institutions, they get big donations. They take care of more people who have commercial paying because they're put on these U.S. News and World Report top rankings. And the hospitals out there that are taking care of the black and brown people, they're getting less funding. They're less able to recruit staff. They have worse staff-to-patient ratios. And it ends up being a cycle, a self-perpetuating cycle. So we need to invest in these hospitals that are taking care of black and brown people, and we need to challenge these hospitals that aren't to do better.
Dr. Jerome Adams, thank you very, very much, as always. We appreciate it.
Well, look, he didn't say that when Donald Trump was in office, that's for sure. I mean, he really kept that racial stuff, that critical race theory at a minimum, didn't he? But by the way, you do realize that's critical race theory.
Oh yeah, of course. But I think that,
which means it's true.
I think that's really, yeah. I think there are a lot of questions that the doc is now able to answer, or even, you know, get asked. He wasn't being asked in the Trump administration because they knew he would not be able to or willing to answer them.
All right, 228-896-9455. Yeah, we're talking about COVID, and it's very, very serious. Now even the VA is opening up rooms now because we are loaded. The ICUs are loaded. Not all of those individuals, patients, are, in fact, COVID patients, but that's the point. Intensive care is intensive care. And because you've got more people with COVID going into intensive care, some of those who have other debilitating disease or serious disease, critical diseases, are jammed up. And look, there are no rooms. Now, here is the thing that kooky conservatives don't want you to grasp, or they can't grasp. They refuse to grasp. And that's it. There is a finite amount of health care we can provide for people. In other words, there's only so many people that can be treated. After then, you don't know. Now that happened in Italy not long ago. Ladies and gentlemen, you had pathologists, these are folks who work with the dead, they do the autopsies and all, and it's being working as physicians, trying to save people. The VA hospital is now open to people. Why? Because there's not only is there a fear, there's a prediction that we're gonna run out of beds. Why, you ask? I'll tell you why. Over the last 3 days, we're topping 20,000 people who have been diagnosed with COVID. Not all of those people are going to be hospitalized, but a significant number of them, if you just took 2% that's going to die, and another 7% who are going to be ill, almost deathly ill. The good thing is that you've got some vaccinations and the death rates are far lower. Who the hell want to be sick for 14 days? This is what conservatives want to lead you to believe. Oh, yeah, well, it's not as bad. It's not as bad as all that. Tell you what you do. You get the disease. You go ahead, you get it, and wonder whether or not you're going to get your next breath, or whether or not your 103 temperature is going to go down, your taste is going to come back, or your smell. And just go ahead, since you feel that being sick is no big deal.
Well, it's no big deal, right? 93% of the people, they don't even go to the hospital.
I have yet to find one person to tell me who's been sick with COVID. Oh yeah, no big deal. I don't know, I've met people who were asymptomatic, so therefore, it was no big deal. But those who got sick, I don't want to get sick again, bro. Ask Tabari. Let's get Larry in. Larry, thank you for being patient.
Doing well,
Larry. And thank you, Larry, for calling. I know that a few days ago I was curt with you, and I apologize to you on the air. I don't know if you heard that, but I'd be more than happy to do it again. I didn't mean to be curt. I do apologize for that.
All right. I understand. You know, sometimes you get emotionally charged on certain subjects.
No, it wasn't emotional. It's just that I was running out of time. You got me? In other words, we were kind of going on and on, and sometimes I'm looking at the clock and my producer's nudging me on, and I'm trying to push you to get to the point. And, you know, but either way, I should not have been curried. I appreciate it.
Well, my reason for calling this morning is that I feel like for the sister to go behind her sister's back and do what she did is unacceptable in no way, no how, because I wouldn't allow the government to do it. And I know some people might say, well, the government and family are different. Not when it comes to trust. Trust is what it is. It doesn't matter where it comes from. Trust is what it is. Secondly, some people, and I hate for people to be ostracized that just not on the vaccinate or die, you know, movement, but some people still have questions about this vaccination, and I don't think that they should be torn down because they have questions about this vaccination, because I do, because I've went in, you know, read articles at the Yale Medical Review, and I've also read articles that the CDC put out. And it just seems like there's not information that's been provided that needs to be provided so people can be more confident and take this vaccination if that's what needs.
You know, I'm going to let you in on a little surprise, and to you and everyone else out there. I do not think that the way we're doing this with vaccinations is the way that we are going to get rid of this. I think that the It is not, as Jerome has said, and even as now Dictator Reeves has said, that we're having the surge of the unvaccinated. I think that's bull. I think the problem we have and have had and will continue to have is a refusal to test and find out who has the disease. The vaccinations have proven that it doesn't limit the infection. I'm vaccinated, I can still get it. Excuse me?
Let's go a little deeper than that.
Well,
we know that millions and millions were infected with COVID-19 prior to the epidemic with the Delta variant.
The Delta variant, yeah.
And it was said that 98% recovered and 2% either, died or just fatally, we'll say died. Not 2% didn't recover. I want to know why that when they say test, why are we not testing for those people to see if they have already built up antibodies due to the fact that they were already infected and have gotten through it versus just want to give everybody antibiotics? Because if you test for this, then you'll find things that may help with producing an antibody for those that 2%.
Well, hang on, it wouldn't be an antibiotic, it'd be a vaccine, but mention it.
I'm sorry, yes.
Yeah, I want you to hang on, Larry, because just there has been a study about this very thing that I'm going to share with you when I come back. It was published Friday by the CDC. Hang on, we'll be back.
Time for spring winnings to blossom during Faux Revanche's $150,000 spring giveaway. Now through May 30th, play to win cash and prizes, including a 2021 Mercedes-Benz.